afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming this afternoon. I think we'll start. Normally we give a bit of time, but I think quite a few people here. So, as you know, that we've started the budget consultations. We've been having consultations, public consultations, face-to-face in Lambasa, Lotoka, and now we're here in Suva. We've also had Facebook consultations. We had something like 50,000 engagements. We had the targeted days where we had students, university students, and then of course we had members of the public. This morning we had public consultations at JJ's, and we are now here meeting the business community. That's what we've done. Not just business community, but various organizations we invited. There's a similar thing we did in Lotoka and also in Mombasa. So thank you for coming this afternoon. I'll very quickly take you through a quick presentation, and then you know, you can then we'll open the floor for any submissions you may have. Generally found in some of the other places what people do, they may ask some questions and then they give the submissions later on because you don't want to go back and write it all up. As I've also said in the other gatherings, that if you have any private issues, we don't deal with that now, but we have staff at the back who take down a complaint in different places. If you say my business application is stuck, or you know, my land title is stuck, that's not the place, this is not the forum, but we still have staff at the back who can actually take submissions from you. In that respect, we'll get in touch with you later. So this is the budget timeline. We are here, of course, now. We've had the various consultations. Like I said, by the 26th of April, you can submit your written submissions. That's the time you've got until. We have, you know, also some internal processes, just so people are aware as the sort of processes we go through internally. So the permanent secretary, we call him Makrita Konrote, who's here in the front line, and her team, they do the assessments for the respective ministries and departments. They all have to give in their submissions for the budget for their respective ministries. And then she sits down on these three dates, 24, 25, 26, with the permanent secretaries of the counter permanent secretary, look at the respective permanent secretaries. So they sit, for example, we sit with the Minister of PS for Fisheries, and they'll, you know, they'll go through the actual submissions themselves and hopefully cut off some numbers and or increase numbers, whatever the case may be. In our case, we like to cut off numbers. Generally, we find that the ministries tend to be a lot more aspirational as opposed to actually, you know, understanding whether they can complete the project in that financial year. So, you know, we're building the Kayasi Hospital, which should be ready by end of December or early next year. Now, that obviously has been spread over two financial periods. So you don't lump, just because it's going to cost $18 million, whatever the case may be, you don't lump that all in one year. You spread it. And of course, in many instances, people don't necessarily understand in the ministries that sometimes the ability for the project to need funds may be limited in the first year. You know, a lot of times we found when we make announcements and the ministry will say we're going to do this ice plant or whatever it is, they may not have even acquired the title to the land. Sometimes they can take even 9 months to do that. So those are the things that we try to fine tune, of course. So that way you better plan, because all governments run deficits. So you don't want to have a higher deficit. You want to have a true reflection of the ability to spend that money. Then once the PS economy has done that, then I sit across the table with the respective ministers and the team. So again, we go through this. You know, so tourism guys may, for example, lobby to the Minister for Tourism. And he may come along and say, look, I want more money. And we may sit down and say, well, hang on, we can't get more money, or this is a way, area that we'll give more money, whatever the case is. We thresh it out, and then we lock in the numbers in this period here, finalize the budget. But now I want to talk to you about, of course, expenditure, but we also have the other side, which is revenue. And we also discussed that, about revenue. We have the CEO of Fiji Revenue Customs Services here. You know, we discussed about revenue measures. Of course, that helps us to not balance the budget, but actually get the finalized figures for the budget itself. We print this year, at least we print the budgets, budget documents, 3rd to the 5th of June. And these are the sort of documentation that actually needs to be printed, which is all available on the website too. The finer details of the budget, I don't know how many, some of you, of course, are accountants, have people going through this with a fine tooth comb, but it has specific details right down to how much each department will spend on postage. Of course, we're in red now, there's no postings. But no, it's right down to that particular detail. And we have all the other respective, you know, materials we put out, rural electrification, regional authority, right down to the minute detail, which village will get how many water tanks and what will be the size of the water tank. We then, on the day of the budget itself, we table the budget documents to Cabinet. Cabinet approves it, and of course, Cabinet has already approved the budget strategy. And then the budget announcement is made on the 7th of June this year, which will be in the evening, as you know, start this trend. The reason why we do budget announcements in the evening is because we want more people to listen to the budget and understand it. Before, it used to be done during the day, and all of you, for employers, would not let your staff go and listen to the budget because you want them to work. So we want them to actually listen to the budget and they should go home. Now, another thing, and some of you, of course, know this, but for those who don't, the budget, when it's announced on the 7th of June, of course, nothing comes into effect once the budget is only approved, which is the parliamentary debate on the 7th and 21st of June. The budget then kicks in from the 1st of August, because the financial year is from the 1st of August to the 31st July. The only thing that kicks in as soon as the budget is announced, which is at midnight on that particular night, is the tariff rates. Tariff actually kicks in by midnight. So cigarettes, alcohol, so, with that introduction, so, little presentation, 9 years of economic growth, and I'll show you where it is at. 40,000 new jobs, unemployment 4.5%, these are of course all figures from the RBA. And, you know, infrastructure has been modernized, you can see that all around, we have heavy investment in health, heavy investment in education and access to public services. I mean, we had the PM this week in Kayasi, in Sanganga, in Tambuni, opening up legal aid offices. In Kayasi, we're building a hospital which will do actual surgeries, x-ray machines and all of that. As I explained this morning, it increases productive capacity because before all those people never had access to those services. It's actually becoming a town, creating a small town in Kayasi. And it creates a lot more efficiency. Before they'd have to come all the way to Singatoga, hire a carrier, in 3-4 hours, the whole day is gone. Now I've built a mortuary in Bukuya. Those of you know Bukuya, it's up in the hills. It's a junction where you go off to Ba and go off to Nandi, and of course you go off to Singatoga. But they never had a mortuary, so before when somebody died up in the hills, you have to carry them all the way down to Singatoga or Nandi. Then when you have the funeral, bring them all back up again. So, I mean, these are the kind of ways that we're improving, of course, access to public services, including BDMs and investment in the digital space for governments. And internationally, of course, you know, with the PM leading the charge on climate change and various other leadership roles we have this year, Fiji for the first time is going to chair the Board of Governors for IMF and World Bank. We are simultaneously the chair of the Small States Forum, the World Bank. We are currently the chair of CTO, Common Telecommunications Organization. But all of this gives us a bigger footprint internationally. It also means we're able to attract a lot more investment, create a lot more awareness about Fiji. And we have to be clever about how we can tap into that positioning internationally for our own benefit. That's the tricky part. Now, we've been talking about the second phase of economic development in Fiji. Great, we have 9 years of economic growth, but what are we going to do more differently to be able to actually capitalize on that? And how you, ordinary citizens, government, civil servants need to think differently to be able to ensure that we gain momentum. Very quickly, you know, GDP in 1970 was $200 million. You can see its progression. Within 9 years, the GDP is doubled, which is quite phenomenal actually, and that's driven by the fact that we have 9 years of straight growth. GDP per capita actually has doubled in the past 10 years. So, I mean, you can see its manifestation out in the streets, what people are buying, what are they buying, the phones they have, the cars they have, how many cars you have on the road, the types of services that are now available, whether it's, you know, having a supermarket that sells what we call in Fiji fancy stuff, and the fact that this fancy stuff is actually being bought, so people have the capacity to be able to buy that. And you know, we find that some of the businesses have not necessarily caught up. So you'll find some businesses have actually remodeled themselves in terms of right from customer service, but others have not necessarily done that. So people are losing out, or people travel a lot more. We travel a lot more than Americans do. So we know, we are aware of types of services and products that are available offshore, and we, our consumers want that too. This is the 9 years of growth that I was talking about. Very low here, of course, because of this thing called Winston. And Winston knocked off about $1.3 billion of our GDP. The rebuild program has cost us almost about $500 million. And, I mean, that's the beauty of having economic growth. You can see when we had MIC, it actually went to negative growth. There were some clever policies we put in place that actually help sustain the economy. Even things like, you know, FNPF releasing funds during that period, $1,000. Some we know did not use it for the rightful purpose, some went to Hong Kong to watch rugby. But the reality is that there was money within the economy to keep the system moving. Projected, normally projections are done for 3 years, and you can see the predictions for the next 3 years. The idea is to, of course, maintain this. And, you know, in the best case scenario, we need that bar to be even higher. Again, you know, these are some of the figures we've shown. Unemployment is 4.5%, 20-year low. RBF ad surveys, job advertisements, actually. And this is the number of new memberships in FNPF. You can see new compulsory membership in 2017, new ones were 20,795. A generally good indication. The number of people that are joining the employment force, the formal employment workforce. That's a good indicator of job growth. This, of course, here is the people who withdraw from FNPF, but compulsory withdrawal. So they are getting out of the workforce. Now, this is the economy. You can see, I mean, these are the areas that contribute to the growth of the economy. A lot of opportunities here. Self tells us a story that maybe there are certain things that are not being done right in forestry and culture, fisheries. This includes sugar too. Manufacturing, of course, is quite significant, as you can see. This is one area that we are excited about, and we believe that there should be a lot more done in this area. 50% of the population is below the age of 27. We all speak English. Some may argue that there is a deterioration in the quality of English. But the reality is we're still attractive in that space. We are very technologically connected. Over 1 million active SIM cards in Fiji. We have only 900,000 people. I think we're close to about 550,000 Facebook users. Very high rate of consumption of mobile phones. A lot of smartphones in that space. A lot of opportunities here. You can see you know, what's happening here. I don't need to read it out all to you. But the trick for any government is that we need to spread, you know, we need to mitigate our losses, or risks, I should say, not losses, mitigate our risks by having a diversified economic base. We simply dependent on one or two to contribute to economic growth. That is not a very good space to be in. I mean, God forbid, for example, if in Winston, it had taken out all the resorts, and we had affected the sugar. We had taken out all the resorts. Most of the resort properties were actually spared. That's why they're able to bounce back very quickly. If they haven't, we would have been devastated. Or we had come through Suva, the Silo. We kissed a lot of the factories goodbye. And we have almost 300,000 people living in this corridor. So we would have had, you know, enormous, causing more enormous impediment in terms of growth of the. Now, yesterday I was down at British American Tobacco. They had launched this, they've got a new investment about worth about $8 million, where they are now going to put in another investment that's going to create a lot more sort of resilience in their processing. So normally when the leaves are grown within 24 hours, they must be brought in, put in the kilns and the dried. and then that's it, and then they take it out to the factory. What they're actually building now is that they're adding another process where they'll actually shred it on site, take out the stem, which causes the sort of fluctuations in humidity. So they can do a stockpile of leaves. When you have a cyclone, and normally the tobacco is grown in Singatoka Valley and Nandi, around the river area, and if there's devastation, then you know, you don't have leaves for 1 year or 2 years. Because also the seedling plant gets damaged too. He knows he's a British American tobacco. Now, but the reality is that now, they've now invested in, for example, greenhouses that can stand up to wind speeds up to category 3. And they're now going to build a new plant of $8 million so they can actually do a stockpile of leaves. So the farmers, you know, they, because what's happened previously in 2016, they came to us and said, look, Winston has taken out all these farms. Now in order for us to keep our secret factory operational, we have to import tobacco. Can you give us a concession on that to keep our factory open? Which we have. We have to do that. So now that they build resilience, they're able to actually, we won't have to give that. But more importantly, they're now going to grow tobacco in bar. They've only grown tobacco in Singatoka and Nandi. Now they intentionally grow tobacco in bar. People already start growing tobacco in bar. So there are farmers who are growing sugarcane, tobacco, and watermelon. These are the kind of sort of opportunities that are created as a result of sort of forward thinking. The other space that we're very interested in, of course, is in the health medical services. You know, I've told this story numerous times, is that you know, we had a very well-known international company that wanted to have a conference and bring about 3,000 people a few years ago. Great location, great people. But because they were going to bring in the top executives, they wanted to know what our medical services were like, just in case one of the executives has a heart attack. So they checked out Notoka Hospital, checked out Nandi Hospital, said thank you very much, and went somewhere else. Now that we've got Aspen coming on board by June, July, and you know, they'll be making various procedures available and they're building a new wing to Notoka Hospital, that's an opportunity that we actually will now gain or get. But more importantly, retirement villages, aged care services, regional tourism and medical services. So the hotels need to come on board. They need to understand the value adding that this will do for them. This is one of the reasons why we've chosen Notoka Hospital, because it's close to Nandi International Airport, strategically done. So we need to think beyond that. So we're already talking to the Aussies about helping us set up courses at FNU so our people can get accredited into short courses in aged care. So when we go out and market Fiji, we can go to an Australian retirement village company and say to them, look guys, come to, you know, there's some land available, set up a retirement village, bring the elderly from Australia, they can stay here during winter, we've got a good hospital, provide 24/7 tertiary care facilities, and by the way, our people are very good as they have their children in looking after our people. So that's the way of thinking we have to think about. I mean, no, there are people, for example, who, in Mauritius, the hotels worked together with the hospitals there. They went off to India, brought people across from India, and people come and get boob jobs from France, and then they stay at the hotel to get a tan, so everything is the same color. That's how the system works. They do plastic surgery. They do all sorts of other procedures too. So Africans come to Mauritius to do heart, open heart surgeries in Mauritius. They don't have to go to France, they don't have to go to India, because Mauritius is only 2-3 hours away. So again, there's sort of, you know, opportunities there that we need to think about. And we think that this is an enormous opportunity for us. Again, investments have increased by, you know, almost over 5% from 2007. Interest rates have been low for a long time. External sector, our foreign reserves are still about $2 billion. I don't have to explain why foreign investment is very important. Our foreign reserves are very important. In inflation, of course, just last year we had, you know, the oil prices around about 34 US dollars a barrel. Today it's hovering around about 80 US dollars a barrel. That of course pushes up inflation too. Tax, of course, you know, just to highlight, we normally do this presentation to the ordinary members of the public. You used to pay tax if you earned $600 between 1974 and 85. Now, of course, you no longer pay any tax. If you earn $30,000, corporate tax has come down. Our tax revenue, you can see, has increased. We need to increase some more too. But, you know, through greater compliance and, of course, a lot more smarter ways of dealing with things. We also, you know, impressed upon FRCS that they need to be a lot more focused on service delivery. They cannot go around acting like Gestapo or whatever. They need to develop a particular method, ways of talking to the taxpayers. They need to treat them as, you know, customers and clients, not as somebody that's, you know, there to be spoken down to or ripped off for that matter. Again, you know, our expenditure has been targeted, infrastructure development. We're spending a lot of money in digital space. You know, we spent about $40 million in this financial year. We'll be doing a lot more. One of the key areas to be interested, of course, it does go to easing the ease of doing business in the area of you know, public office, panel's office. We're working with Singaporeans, they're quite good, and you'll see a lot of traction probably in the next 12 months or so. We're launching a particular product, hopefully the PM will do that in about 2 weeks' time, where at the moment if you give birth at a hospital, you get a birth notification card, which you then bring to BDM downstairs and register your child and get a birth certificate. When we launch this product, we can go on your smartphone, so our, you know, females giving birth in the hospital, she can then sort of lodge for her birth, son or daughter's birth certificate. Fill in all the details, submit it to BDM, and say what time she'll come and pick up birth certificate. So those things are being done. Of course, we need to encourage people to register. Because we found we did a sweep about 4 or 5 years ago, it should be a bit longer than that, where we found about 25,000 Fijians were registered who did not have a birth certificate. So there was always 55 years old. One was actually 65 years old. So if we do not get the data early, then how can we plan better? We need that data accessibility. And very soon that app you'll be able to get e-birth certificates, because you'll find BDM downstairs, just before the school is about to start, we have long queues. We have to open it till in the evening, we open it on Saturdays. A lot of people don't actually register their child, you'd be surprised, until they're about to go to school. And they go around there asking for birth certificate because the school wants a birth certificate. So we hope to, with the Singaporeans, be offering, you know, e-birth certificates, etc. A lot of things we're doing in that space. A lot of it requires a lot of background work first. You know, again, economic and social policies need to be designed to empower Fiji and support private sector activity. Again, consistency in policies. You've seen we have not done many variations of tax rates. We've been very consistent in the past few years. Be able to give the private sector confidence. OPEX versus CAPEX, I don't have to explain too much in detail, but around about, you know, 12 years ago, if you look at it, OPEX was about 85% of the entire budget spend, only 15 in CAPEX. Today it's 59-41. That's why you see a lot more investment in infrastructure. This year alone, for example, we're spending $50 million in rural electrification. Interestingly, this figure is, you can get this figure from anywhere. From 1980 to 2006, that's 27 years, whichever government was in power spent $3.5 billion cumulative in capital expenditure, and the debt increased by $2.6 billion. Today, from 11 years, 2007 till now, we spent over $7 billion, doubled it. But our debt has increased by $2.3 billion. So whilst we doubled it, our debt was still lower than the infrastructure spend that they had between 80 and 2006. The reason why that is because previously, from that period, every dollar they spent on CapEx, 76 cents was borrowed. In our time since 2007, only 36 cents is borrowed because we have a surplus operating position. That's the why. Again, you know, I don't have to explain this to you, all of you are you know, this about measuring debt. A lot of people, politicians, because of last year's politics and whatever, people talk only about nominal figures. It's, oh, Fiji's debt is 5.1 billion. But actually, as a percentage of our GDP, it's been decreasing. There's only quirk here is that, of course, about 50% here now, because of the rebuild, you know, Josie, Kenny, Gita, all of that. So, in fact, if you took off $500 million here, it would be about, you know, well, $100 million is 1%, it would be 5% less, it would be about 45% at least, the debt to GDP ratio, if those cyclones did not take place. Just in comparison, let me very quickly show this to you, so people understand. Debt to GDP ratio of these countries, debt to GDP ratio of Japan is 239.2%. Singapore, US, nobody says those economies are failing. But if you look at USA, which is the most debt-ridden country in the world in terms of nominal figures, 107.4%, we sit here. In US dollars, you can see that ours is 2.42, that's in US dollars, of course. US is $19.9 trillion, that's the total debt exposure for the government. And in countries like Canada, have $1.4 trillion debt, debt to GDP ratio is $9.3 billion. Australia's debt, of course, but as a percentage, is lower than ours, about 41.1, but of course, nominally, they're a lot higher than us, it's about 17.3 billion. So, you know, it's all relative, but this, of course, is a much better way of measuring debt, in particular for governments, because governments don't run to make a profit. It's nice to have surpluses, but you don't run to make a profit. I mean, if you come and get a message to get downstairs, cost $2.25. There's not even enough money to pay for the printing and the ink, and the staff and the hire of the printer. But we have to do that because that's a service we need to provide to members of the company. So budget strategy, which has been approved by Cabinet, is that we have to have, you know, strong, sustained investments, economic development pieces. We need to create that, embrace a new wave of development thinking beyond what we've thought about. Inclusivity, empowerment of all Fijians, providing great opportunities. And we have various issues. I mean, as I told the gathering this morning, the chair of EFL was telling us just a few months back, New Zealand, one of the New Zealand electricity companies, took 25 highly trained and skilled linesmen of EFL. 25 gone just overnight. We have at the moment a shortage of teachers in New Zealand. In particular in science and physics and maths, guess where they're taking them from? We now have a huge shortage in that space. So, you know, we have this kind of attrition, and then we need to be able to put in place strategies to be able to address that. We, of course, will fill more in a smaller country. We expect the fiscal deficit, obviously, to continue down the path. We had a strategy before Winston, and you can see over here, and our strategy, we were actually fulfilling that to bring it down. So the bar is supposed to go all the way down. But of course, we have got this bit of a bump here because of this thing with these Kenny and Josie and Peter. Still maintain low and attractive tax rates. We need to continue to do this, streamline taxation, customs, industry approaches. I know in some areas it requires a lot more work. Of course, we still need to tighten compliance. Big issue for us, some of you may be doing this, hopefully none of you are in this room. When we reduce duty give various concessions on tax, the retailers, the wholesalers aren't passing that on to the consumers. The reason why we do that is so consumers can afford these. You know, whether it's apples or whether it's to do with baby products, the whole idea is to make it cheaper. Or more, you know, more palatable for these. This needs to continue. There's, of course, there's now an insatiable, what I call an insatiable appetite for Fijians to have every road in Fiji fixed up overnight. For everybody to have water and electricity. So, you know, I'm not saying that we have to feed the insatiable appetite, but we need to ensure that there is actually growth, continued growth in that area. Clean water, electricity is still very important. Education, skills development, that's what I was talking about earlier on. We've asked the Aussies to help us in respective areas for that or in that, and support SME developments, self-help initiatives, things like that, young entrepreneurs. Very important for us, this increasing of home ownership. We are signing something with the IFC next week. We'll see some announcements made in that respect, but we want to have a huge level of traction. Those of you who have deep pockets in the area of investment, I urge you to also look at the various incentives available for taxation breaks in that area for investment, because government cannot do this alone. So the way, for example, public rental housing has been approached in Fiji is that when government has a bit of money, then we build, you know, 25 public rental flats in Kalambo or Simla or Suvavou or Tawakubu, whatever. You cannot do that. You need to have a huge stockpile of homes built. And we've talked to FNPF and various other people that they should invest in that space. So government does not get into capital expenditure, but we're quite happy to support an investment package. Put simply, you're going to put up, say, 1,000 flats, and you say that in order for me to get my rate of return, I need $100 a flat. And at the moment, if somebody, you know, low-income people are paying, say, $50 a month, then government can step in and say, okay, we'll pay the balance of the $50. But we don't have the upfront capital costs, and government can in the business of subsidizing, but also, you know, look out the set up body corporates and companies. I urge those of you who have lots of money, or I know people who have lots of money, very attractive taxation rates. In fact, we've got an investment rebate on that too. So that's one of the ways that we're looking at dealing with that issue. Because the reality is that a lot of people, you know, who may be working for you or work, for example, in banks, some of their homes are actually on top of a bankrupt swap. People are earning $30,000, $40,000, some of them don't have the capacity to buy a home or afford to buy a home. And we need to get into that space. And the concept of what is a home needs to change. Fiji, when you say a home, it means a block of land with a house in the middle. It should be apartments, you know, getting 99 units. Those types of things we need to get into. Of course, you know, agriculture, sugar, resource-based sectors. Digital connectivity is very important for us. So, there you go. So, as I said, we can give you submissions by 26th of April. Of course, you can email it, hand deliver, post it. Shiri here, Shiri Gandhi is here in the front, those of you may not know Shiri, he's the head of fiscal planning. You can call Shiri and talk to him. I know some people are already having discussions with him. You know, we look forward to your contribution. So the whole idea is as to how we can, you know, work together with you, with your organizations, and to be able to get onto this, what we call the second phase of economic development. We need to change the ways in which we look at the economy, the way we look at the business environment, to be able to ensure that we take advantage of the past 9 years of growth. There are some very, you know, strategic decisions we do need to make. And I also urge everybody, again, this is available on our website. I don't know how many have actually read our 5-20-year plan, very important. Many people have not read that. Please do so, in particular, you, most of you are leaders in your own sectors and organizations, and you need to understand where we are. We're also having a meeting with all our development partners on the 29th of this month. It's interesting, it's meeting everybody that's going to contribute to Fiji's development, including donors and various other organizations, even in our countries on a bilateral basis, to give them a presentation as to what we are doing. So we want programs to complement what we're doing. There needs to be complementarity as opposed to them going off and doing something else. And if we have a kind of concerted approach to it, then we, you know, we think that we can very quickly achieve those objectives. Thank you very much. And let's open up the floor. There's somebody going around with the mic. Like I said, please, you can make some points or you have some questions that you may have, but please, we don't expect you to stand there and speak for half an hour. Or read out a submission, but it would be good to hear from you. I know for the last time we did pick up some good points that were picked up, and today there is somebody who's talking about investments, or give us $100 million and we'll be able to do X, Y, Z. That was not necessarily relevant, but some of the points they made actually made us think, got us thinking about certain aspects, what we can do. There you go. Thank you.